Buying a new vehicle, or a new-to-you vehicle, can be quite the exciting experience. You likely get to drive a bunch of different vehicles before making that all-important purchase decision. You've probably done a bunch of research into the different vehicle types and their approximate costs. Hopefully you've watched a ton of videos on this channel. And if you're buying from a dealership, at least in much of the world, the chances are you've already got an idea of which colours and packages you're willing to accept and which models you'd prefer to stay clear of. But in the EV world, there's a whole host of extra things you might not have thought about and, having just purchased my second brand new EV in the US last month, I've realised that there's a bunch of things that happened during my personal purchase process that, had I not known exactly what was happening, could have presented a massive stumbling block for myself and the dealership. And I work in the EV industry. So today, we're digging down into some of those things. I'm going to explain what you should brush up on before heading off to the dealership to seal the deal, and I'm going to make sure you understand some of the specific terms you might need to know and what the impact of that might be on the overall price you pay. Let's get on with it. Before I get too in-depth in this video, I just want to acknowledge that how you buy a new car varies greatly depending on where in the world you live and what exactly you're buying. In the US, for example, it's usually most common for people to buy a new car by heading to their local dealership and seeing what's on the lot. You pick out a vehicle from the available ones there and then haggle on a price. In some cases, as is slowly becoming the case with Ford and a few other automakers, and as I did myself, you might even be able to ask your local dealership to find a car that meets your exact requirements nearby, and then they do a trade with the other dealership where said car happens to be, so that you can get the vehicle you want at the dealership you want instead of one that's the wrong colour or has optional extras you really don't need. Then there's the majority of EV-only brands, which, for the most part, will usually ask you what vehicle you'd like to buy and then either custom order or find a matching vehicle in inventory. You then have to wait for that vehicle to arrive. That method of buying is what I used to be familiar with in the UK. The four times we purchased new cars in the UK, we headed to the dealership for a test drive of a vehicle they had on the forecourt as a demonstrator, then headed inside and spec'd out a vehicle with all of the features and packages we wanted. Then we agreed on a price, and then we waited for a few weeks, or sometimes a month, for that vehicle to be made and then shipped to our local dealership, or in fact, for it to be shipped from a central inventory location where vehicles are held prior to sale. The only exception of that was the Nissan Leaf, which I had access to prior to the vehicle's launch because I'm a motoring journalist. I'm telling you this all because there's a significant chance that if you're watching this in the US, you might not know that the other ways of buying new cars exist. And if you're from outside of the US, you also might not know how things are traditionally done here in the USA. And believe me, it is quite the culture shock, along with plenty other things.
I distinctly ordered the Antarctic Blue Super Sports Wagon with the CB and the optional Rally Fun Pack.
There are other ways of doing this for sure, but those are the standard for most people scenario. More and more automakers are now adopting the direct-ish to customer sales mode, which is a bit of a hybrid between how, say, Tesla has traditionally done it and how it's done in Europe. And Tesla is, interestingly, more and more often relying on in-inventory cars to sell to customers in a way that's closer aligned to how franchise dealerships have done it in the past. And of course, Polestar, Volvo, and others are experimenting with new ownership models that are completely different to what we've seen before. Basically, I'm not going to cover every way in detail in this video. That would be a video in itself. Sorry. For the purpose of this video, I'm going to focus primarily on buying a car in the US, but some of what I am going to say does apply to other markets as well. And of course, Obligatory disclaimer time. I'm not a financial advisor or a tax professional, and I don't play one on the internet. Consult with people who are before making any substantial purchase decision. Don't come after me. And don't ask someone who just plays those things on the internet. Find a real one. As I just noted, we're focusing on US car buying, and these tips are primarily going to focus on the physicality of buying a car rather than picking the car that's right for you, because we have done plenty of those videos in the past, and I'll link to some of them below. So let's start with the before you head to the dealership list. The first thing to bear in mind is that dealer staff aren't always as well-versed in the vehicles they're selling you as you might expect, especially when it comes to talking about electric vehicles. Traditionally, unfortunately, the role of selling EVs has been given to the least experienced of the sales team, often because older team members aren't interested in selling EVs, or because prospective EV owners have traditionally been seen as quite an easy sell, as they are usually more motivated to buy an EV than an ICE car buyer is to buy a particular ICE vehicle. Occasionally, though, you will encounter a sales professional who really does know their stuff and is enthusiastic about EVs at a regular old dealership. And sometimes you'll even find an EV salesperson at a dedicated EV showroom who is anything but. So don't take anything for granted when it comes to sales staff competency. This unfortunately means you really do need to do your homework about the vehicle before you go in. Make sure you understand exactly what's included with the vehicle you're looking at the point of sale, and that includes knowing if there's a free charging station with your car or a free portable charging unit under the floor, and how powerful each of those are. I have seen and heard of dealerships charging people extra for a portable charging cable when there was one listed as free with the vehicle from the automaker. I've seen people charged for an at-home charging station when it was included free of charge with some special purchase incentive from said automaker. I've also lost track of the number of people who have told me of cars they've just purchased which they thought had quote-unquote fast charging, only to discover much too late that the dealership referred to fast charging as meaning the car would charge more quickly from a dedicated level 2 charging station when compared to the level 1 portable unit the car came with, when the person buying the car thought that fast charging meant actual fast charging at a DC fast charging site. If dealerships can get the basics about your vehicle wrong, and I myself have had disputes over what packages are included on new vehicles and what packages are standard or not, then it is fair to say they might not know a whole lot about the actual purchase process for an electric car. And again, I'm unfortunately pulling from my own experience here. Before you head to your dealership or even think about signing any new papers for your EV, you'll need to have some important information that will help you along your way. The first is a knowledge of what's currently available in terms of incentives for your particular vehicle based on where you live. The first part of this is knowing if your vehicle is in fact eligible for any local or national incentives. In the US, for example, these incentives have changed a little in recent years, with the current eligibility requirements for the 2024 model years very different to previous years. You'll not only need to know that the car's MSRP is under the maximum allowable amount for incentives, more on that later, but you'll also need to know how much of an incentive your vehicle is eligible for. And this, unfortunately, will depend on where the vehicle was made, where key components for the vehicle, like the battery pack, came from, and a whole host of other things that I'm not going to go into. Because sadly, this is a metaphorical minefield, with multiple EVs in recent years undergoing changes in eligibility during their actual production run. In some cases, for example, it's even down to agreements or exemptions being granted on particular dates. So it's super important to be aware that some vehicles made, for example, last year and sold this year won't be eligible for US federal tax incentives, but identical models that were made this year will qualify for those same incentives. Like I say, it's incredibly messy. The second thing you'll need to know are some key facts and figures about your own finances, especially if you're buying using a credit package provided by the dealership or automaker. Traditionally, it's always been wise to shop around for a good deal on a finance package, and that's certainly still the case, although based on current interest rates in countries like the US, it is becoming increasingly hard to find a banking institution willing to give you a finance package that will beat the current pretty low interest rates that most automakers are offering. That said, I find that local credit unions are often some of the more flexible places to go for a loan, especially if you're a long-time customer. In addition to knowing what credit rates you've got access to outside of your dealership, make sure that you're aware of the rates that are being offered by a headline automaker deal and check to see if you qualify for them, at least on paper. This means making sure you know your credit score and that you've carried out the required credit thawing that you will need to ensure the dealership finance person can actually go ahead and carry out a credit check if indeed you're looking at using dealership or automaker finance packages. I used to assume that everyone knew about the practice of freezing their credit reports, but these days I've learned that not everyone does know about it. It is free, doesn't take long to set up, and prevents people from using your personal information to set up fraudulent loans and accounts under your name. Unfreezing your credit report is also free, and it is easy to refreeze after you've done the necessary credit applications. Next, at least if you're using auto dealer credit or going through a lease program, you'll likely need to know more than just how much money you make on paper. Like most financial applications, the loan officer or financial person at the dealership will want to know specific figures based on your most current completed tax return, as well as your current employment. So be ready with that information. And as a side note, if you run your own business, be ready and willing to explain the differences between things like gross income and adjusted gross income, because the last time I purchased a vehicle, I needed both those figures, which in my case were vastly different when we actually filed out the application for the loan and then the tax credit paperwork, which, as it happens, brings me very nicely to the matter of nomenclature and what different terms mean. The last time we purchased a new EV, the replacement for the Ford F-150 Lightning, I sadly crashed back in February. The finance person at our local dealership didn't understand the difference between what was listed by the dealership as MSRP and the definition of MSRP as laid out by the US federal government. And it's different. In case you're interested, right now, the US federal government's MSRP definition for an EV is the suggested retail price set out by the automaker plus any optional extras fitted to the vehicle by the automaker before it arrived at the dealership. That price is before any sales discounts or trade-ins, and it's also before mandatory shipping and handling fees are added, or before, in fact, any dealer added options are put on. Knowing this fact can be the difference between finding your new EV qualifies for incentives and being told that no, it doesn't. In my most recent purchase case, I had to argue the point with the dealership, and I actually showed them a copy of the IRS's official page for EV tax incentives to argue that no, shipping and handling wasn't part of the MSRP for the purchase incentive. Be ready as well to dispute things that just randomly appear on your invoice. Sometimes dealerships will add optional things and hope you don't notice. I once had a dealership add an optional service package and extended warranty, which significantly put the price up. They quickly took it off after I complained and threatened to walk out. Basically, slowing down and reading everything and knowing exactly what's included and what you're paying for is super important. And like I said, knowing exactly what your vehicle should come with is just as important as knowing the APR of your particular finance package. finally, and this one is applicable to every single new car, whether it's from a dealership that's franchised or you're buying from an automaker-owned sales center, you need to insist on checking everything out before you sign. Or if, like me, you happen to sign the documents before the vehicle is at the dealership, do a thorough vehicle inspection before you head off in the sunset with your fancy new car. Bring a ruler and a camera. It's a real bonus, as it proves categorically that any flaws or defects you notice in bodywork or interior trim are at a given size and are in a given location. It helps prove that panel gaps are a certain width, while maybe another one is much smaller or in fact larger. And every single person I know who didn't go through this process and didn't identify those issues at the point the keys were handed over has experienced some level of Dante's hell in order to get those things documented and fixed after the process. Sure, you won't get every little niggle, but highlighting issues is an important part of getting that new ride. And finally, if things are not to your satisfaction, be willing to refuse delivery until the things are fixed. Tesla and some other brands are now heavily leaning into the notion that you must accept the vehicle in its current state or else. But at the end of the day, if something isn't up to your standards, you're the buyer. You are totally within your rights to walk away and wait until those things are fixed. So there you have it. Some tips about the things you need to be aware of and be ready for when you buy a new vehicle, or in fact, you buy a certified used one from a dealership or a sales center. Have I missed anything? If I have, let me know below. Thanks for joining me today. And if you've got thoughts, make sure you leave them below in our Discord chat room, or you can reach out to us on Mastodon. Thanks to the amazing list of people scrolling by on your screen right now. They are some of the more than 1,500 people that help make this channel possible by funding it through Patreon and YouTube, covering our bills, paying our team, and making sure we can be 100% independent. If you'd like to join them and see your name listed here, just follow the links below. There are a range of different tiers you can sign up for, from as little as $1 a month, or if you pay yearly, $10.08 a year. A massive welcome to our newest supporters, Ralph Koenig, Mr. Eldritch, Dwayne Ediger, and Corey Singletray. To join our list and get your shout out, become a paid Patreon member for your week of fame. If you'd like to support us with a one-off donation, you'll also find links below to make Ko-fi and Bitcoin donations, and we even have an old-fashioned PO box you can reach us at. The address is listed below. And of course, if you're in need of some swag, you'll find our swag store link in the down below as well. This month, we are celebrating Wrangling EV FUD with a fantastic t-shirt design by our in-house artist and animator, Erin. Get yours today by heading to our Redbubble store. We've got some great content coming up, so make sure you're subscribed on PeerTube or YouTube, and we'll see you soon. We make new videos every Monday, Wednesday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. If you want more, the mighty algorithm thinks you'll like this video, but we also think that this one is well worth a look. See you soon, and as always, keep evolving.